millions to our wonderful viewers all across this world, especially to our fellow Guyanese. As citizens of our beautiful country, we remind ourselves of our responsibility in seeing our country goes forward. Guyana is a blessed country with great potentials, enormous wealth, great opportunities, and fantastic scenery. With this in mind, we challenge ourselves to unite, put our hearts, our hands, and our minds together to develop this beautiful country of ours. Let us remember to put God first, love Him and honor Him. I quote from one stanza from the song, If We Forget God, by the Louvin Brothers. Quote, if we forget God, His mercy will flee, and sin will cover the land and the sea. If we forget God, Satan will rule. If we forget God, our nation is doomed. Welcome to Choices. God bless you. God bless Guyana.
And on that same note, I want to we want to reflect on our discussion that we started last week. We noted that if we don't have to wait until we have troubles and struggles, until there is conflict before we recognize that there is a transcendent God, that there is a God who is capable and who could bless us in all times. And so, coming back to what Pastor Singh just said, that we have a responsibility not to forget God because of who He is and what He's capable of doing. And so as we consider the topic being set free, we looked at Isaiah 5. We made mention of the different typologies of groups of people that we've seen in the world over time. We talked about the silent ones, very few. Those are the very older ones. We talked about the baby boomers. We talked about the Xers. We talked about the millennials and the Zers. But all of these groups are well positioned for the building of a relationship that could cause everyone to be empowered and everyone to be capable of advancing and moving forward. The issue arose whether the Word of God is relevant for a particular group of people, and we established the fact that the Word of God is relevant for every group. And of course, we were drawn to Deuteronomy, where we observe in Deuteronomy 6, and, from 8, Moses writing talked about the commandments that you should give, that he has given, that the Lord has given us today, and what we should do with those commandments in terms of teaching. And he spoke about impressing them on our children. We should talk to them when we sit down at home, when we walk along the road, when we lie down, when we get up, and tie them as symbols on your hands, bind them on your foreheads. And all of this speaks to teaching diligently. And so it is important that we teach with a certain degree of diligence that will impact the generations to come. So the older ones, we have a responsibility to teach the younger ones so that they may live and that we may experience the progression that we want to see. So today we want to continue on the topic being made free. Gentlemen.
We didn't have access to an Android or an iPhone, but Solomon wrote words that are enduring. In Ecclesiastes 1 and verse 4, it said, one generation passeth away, and another generation cometh, but the earth abideth forever. Amazing, amazing words. One generation, long before the concept of baby boomers, Xers, millennials, Zers, whatever conceptualized, you know, was ever developed, Solomon was able to capture the idea that the world is intergenerational, that we, one generation might be dominant, and that generation is responsible for ensuring certain things happen upon the face of the earth, under the sun. But that generation will pass, and he saw another generation coming. And so there was always a relay. There's always the passing of a baton from one group to another group. Sometimes at the passing, at that point you have confusion. At that point you have the dropping of the baton. At that point you have runners disqualifying the entire team by their actions. And I mean, as a former athlete, you understand what I'm talking about. You and I ever run 100?
in
back in the day.
Intentional.
Yeah. Somebody was going to be smelling my eggs back in the day. But the important thing is, at that point you have a crisis. You have some challenges. Here we are in the 21st century. What do we pass on to the next generation? I think that is the major challenge. And we're trying to pass values on that may only be relevant to the secular environment. If we do that, the Louvin brothers, those, the quotation, the nation is doomed if we only try to do that. Thank you very much for reminding us of that beautiful golden song. So we have a challenge. We have to transmit not a section of the gospel, but the whole gospel.
And Bishop, if I may add, you're talking values, and taking traditional values, taking into consideration the portion of scripture that Pastor Hudson read. Most of us, we own our own homes, and as a means of caution, we might have ferocious dogs, and we put beware of the dogs. Using the scripture that was read in Deuteronomy about putting the word of God on the doorposts and on the gate, but how significant that would be. You know, sometimes I'm coming off the East Coast along the railway line, I think it's just somewhere in the vicinity of Conversation Tree, and there's a house, a beautiful home with John 3:16 inscribed on it. You know, you might have different religious sects or organizations, people in your community, but imagine John 3:16 on the doorpost or on the gate, and every time that person passes, they can't help but read, and the impact that can have after a while on that person. So as we think about values and passing on the word of God, I think there are certain things we can do that can be so significant.
No, Pastor, I was saying to someone recently that it seemed as if the older I get, I always remember something my parents taught me. I don't know why, as you go along, I remember my parents said, do it this way. Oh, I remember them said, don't do that. And it speaks to the level of responsibility we have to the generation coming. And we sometimes, I believe, judge them because they are different. They are not within your generation, and you become very judgmental. And because of being judgmental, you refuse the responsibility of passing on. We just cannot do that. Because if the generation coming does not benefit from the experience and the knowledge of the past, they will have to experiment, they'll have to do all the scientific work all over again, and they will spend more time wasting time. There's no shoulder to build upon. And at the end of the day, there will be a decline rather than a growth. So the point I'm emphasizing is the responsibility we have to help the generation come. And stop going around condemning. That will solve the problem. Stop going around claiming how you don't know. That still doesn't answer the problem. You have to find a way to transmit values. And I will put three values on the table, according to Michael. Justice, mercy, humility will help you in any public service job you do.
You know, in Deuteronomy, what we read here, it's critical because the children of Israel were about to enter the promised land. And what was being communicated here is that there was an incumbent responsibility on the older ones to communicate and to pass on. The older one having first experienced the goodness and the grace of God, it was their responsibility to teach what they had experienced, the goodness of God, because in the promised land, they were going to experience other gods or to see the manifestation of other gods. But what was going to make them really prosperous was the fact that they were meant to hold on to what God, Jehovah God, had done, what Jehovah God did for the forbearance. So in transmitting, we must not only just communicate values, what we would have read or seen, but more importantly, I believe, what we would have experienced. So I think in transmitting values to the younger generation, we must communicate to them what God did for us, how we experienced God, the difficulties that we would have gone through and experienced, how God brought us through, the blessings that God has given to us. We must communicate that in simple language, but at the same time, we must tell them what
God
did for us.
That's so important, even as you spoke there. I'm thinking of that not only the gods that they may have experienced, but I'm also thinking about the children of Israel, because they were going into a land that was described with, as a land with milk and honey, which suggests that this land would have brought some degree of prosperity and blessing to them. And lots of times, if we're not careful as to who God is, who's the provider, who set the stage for us to be blessed and so on, sometimes we could lose it because our focus could be shifted from the blesser
to
the blessing. So we shift our focus from the source. And I think Moses was very careful to, you know, that the conduct of the children of Israel, even as they go into this prosperity, that they needed to conduct themselves well, so that they would be always on a trajectory that will be developmental. The moment that we saw it, actually, in terms of the behavior, when they shifted, we saw the issues that they faced, the problems that they experienced. So we have a responsibility to teach our young people today also, because many of our children, they might be educated, they may have good jobs, but because they're not making the wise, right decisions, because they're not taught properly certain values, like you mentioned, justice, you know, hard work and love for God and love for man, they lose everything. Some of them have turned into paupers because they shifted, the focus would have been shifted.
Somebody, notwithstanding everything that we have said so far, in the marketplace, somebody who does not share our view has got control of the mute button. So what happens? In our attempt to transmit these values to the next generation, you have another force that says you can talk those things in your home. You can share those things in your private space, but you cannot share it in the marketplace. And so there is, and whoever is pressing this mute, we don't know. But they seem to be very powerful. And like Fantastic Four, remember that Marvel cartoon? That person has got a hand that can reach all over and through everything. But we have to say to our young people, notwithstanding those challenges, you still have a duty to transmit these values. And as Moses said, these are words that command you. They shall be in your heart. They shall be in your heart. That's the first place. They should be in your heart. But there's a lot of competition for what is in your heart right now. And we are even becoming sympathetic to the enemy, you know, in our heart. That's the reason why we're allowing them to mute us. And they're even describing us as being haters. You know, and we are deciding that we are going to not wanting to be characterized as haters or homophobic, as they would say, we decide to, you know, denute us. No, you cannot afford that. The next generation, it must be in your heart, the values, the principles of the Word of God, and not just be in your head, it must be in your heart. And this is, and thou shalt, once they're in your heart, you will teach them diligently unto your children, and they shall talk of them, they shall talk of them,
yes.
You know, they shall talk of them when you sit down, when you walk in the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and be as frontlets between your eyes. And so there's a duty. Don't allow, don't become ashamed or afraid to transmit these values.
And I think what has happened, you know, the person with the mute button has also found it profitable to plug in some earphones. So we have the earphones in our ears and it's blocking out the communication or the information that you should get when you sit and talk. You sit in and people are having conversation and the earphones plugged in. That is so embarrassing. It is so disrespectful. That when you supposed to be listening for instructions, that the button would not fall. You can't hear it because you're distracted.
Yeah. Well, Dr. Messiah, you made mention of a very interesting concept earlier in the deliberations, talking about intergenerational. And I believe because of the fact that values have a way of transcending generations, it's very important that we teach. It seems as if it's a lifelong, it's more than an event, it's a lifelong responsibility. And the Moses in Deuteronomy did not only impress upon our hearts to teach them diligently, but he look at the strategy thereafter. When you talk, when you walk, when you lie down, when you sit. So it seems if we have to stay with the process. And some people, they wait until, or they pray for their children to reach a certain age, and they say, well, I'm done with that. But we have to stay with them. We have to, and I mean, when you look at, in our education system, especially at the nursery level, you see those teachers, they have all these teaching aids. Those things are intentional and deliberate, because the children, you see so many posters and flyers and things that will help that child to remember. So we have to come alongside, notwithstanding the muters, but we have to continue to encourage our children as we practice, as we teach, as we come along.
Well, look what we want to say here even further. I mean, to my mind, it's not just only to teach, but those to whom we communicate values, they have a responsibility to reflect it in their thinking.
Because it must be reflected in the thinking.
Whatever they write or whatever they do, because it's meant to affect the hand also. Yeah. It is meant to affect the forehead, which is thinking, and the doorpost. Moses is speaking here. This is BC, and we are in 2018, and he's talking about affecting the environment in which you live. So it's not just to be personal values alone,
right,
but those values must transcend wherever we find them.
I think I heard this.
You say personal environment, and it must go to its natural conclusion. Community,
yeah.
The entire marketplace,
yeah.
You know, not just our personal sphere, but community, marketplace. So, strategic evil is causing or has caused lots of good men to remain quiet, you know, in board meetings, quiet in that day. Here, they have all these values in their heart, and they study, and by dint of hard work and the grace of God, they've now risen to top positions, not only locally, but regionally and for the field. But only your personal, only your family, your community, mm-hmm. your immediate environment is benefiting. You have to come out and bring these values, these other values to play. You've demonstrated the application in your personal life, but you think it stops there. We have a duty now to take it outside of our personal sphere into the marketplace. So folks will ask, why do you think the way you think? Why do you behave the way you behave? Why do you operate the way you operate? And then you get an opportunity to share where you're from. Just wanted to add that.
I'm glad you brought that back, because I wanted, when you raised it earlier, I wanted to piggyback on it and something that Reverend Hudson said. Many years ago, and I give compliments to my biological father, we were dealing with an issue of school bullying. And he said to me, every time someone wants to get rid of you, they will give you a name. They will first name you. Your enemy will always try to name you. And if you follow that name, they will control you. And I find that lots of times, because of being branded, you refuse to stand for what you really believe. And I'm glad that he taught me that, because over the years I've had to learn how to ignore the name and just move on with what you believe. And but Reverend Hudson made the observation
the
about...
The church is homophobic.
You just ignore the name. And Reverend Hudson, when he spoke about the old issue about, he didn't say it this way, but be careful when you grow up who you pass, because on your way down you may meet them. Now, lots of times we forget where God brought us from. Mm-hmm. And again, there are life lessons you learn. And because of acquiring, attaining, without problem, structural training, you now start to treat people as if they are insignificant. They don't matter. They are not valuable. And you walk on them. Now, that tells me that there's a lack of proper development and training. And it means, therefore, that you need that kind of moral structure inside of you. Which brings me back to my final point. That for all of us to be able to be successful, we need a community. And I'm glad, Pastor, you brought that. We need to recognize each other, value each other, and support each other.
The word diligent in the portion of Scripture, it is not there by mistake. It was intentional, and I think Pastor Paul, like I told you, talked about you liking the teaching aid and so on, and the teachers do that because you want to reinforce concepts so that the concept will not be lost. More than just abstract kind of teaching, just words. And so Moses talked about being diligent. And Moses must have catered for the muters, and those are the remote who would want the muters. Because you see, if someone is teaching diligently, you will not allow yourself to be distracted by, you know, what whoever is doing. That's right. And so I even just went to the dictionary. I saw diligent is characterized by steady. That's what it means, steady. It means earnest, energetic. It talks about, and it even has some synonyms, active, bustling, busy, assiduous. And so Moses is saying that as we teach, you cannot afford to be distracted. You have to just be diligent, keep teaching. And the concept, at some point in time, it will take traction. I think sometimes we lose the battle because we give up based upon the distraction that may come.
You see, the intent of God is really to bless us. The children of Israel, they were going into a land flowing with milk and honey. This is major blessings after a period of time in the wilderness. And so these instructions that were given were there to produce like the foundation for the blessing. You know, I read a book by T.D. Jakes that says, can you stand to be blessed? You know, when God is getting ready to just download it on you, you gotta be able to receive it.
you have to be able to be strong enough to weather the storm, to not allow the blessings. And lots of us, we could attest to that very many times. The blessings come and we stumble, we fail. So this intentional instruction was given to the children of Israel so that when God was getting ready to really put that blessing upon them, they would be able to bear it. As a matter of fact, if you look at the other verses, he said, take heed after you would have gotten houses and vineyards that you didn't plant and so on and so forth. Here the next part, although the instruction was given, don't forget your God. I mean, I love what Pastor Singh said earlier. This nation cannot forget God. You cannot forget God. You cannot forget the principles. So that's why the word diligent is so critical, because so critical, because what God is getting ready to do, you really need that kind of foundation so that you could really build.
Now, Dr. Messiah, I think I heard this phrase from you. I don't know if you're the original coiner of that phrase, but you don't get what you expect, you get what you inspect.
And that.
Okay, great, thank you. And now, to my mind, the whole notion of community comes in here, where you move not just beyond your own, not just your children, but you watch out for others, and have that time and that responsibility to make sure that you inspect.
We forget God to our parent, and I can't remember all the words, the exact quote from the Louvian brothers. If we forget God, a nation is doomed, they said. But there are those among us who would want us to forget God. And they allowed, they let their voices be heard. And listen to me, they are even facilitated in society. Every view that they have, they allow them to be amplified. But we must be aware, you must be aware, in the privacy of your own home, wherever you view this. You guys who drink beers, you talk to us. You view this from your while you're relaxing. If you forget God, a nation is doomed. So personally, we do not enjoy that luxury of forgetting God, because the consequences are known. Bless you, Mrs. Choices.
We thank you for joining us on Choices today. Remember, you can join us at First Assembly, LNP Durban Street, Workmanville, Georgetown, Guyana, for any of our special services. I'm Salacia on behalf of the set, reminding you that your whole life is the sum of your choices. God bless you.